I'm ready.
Oh, no.
How are you? Northern Ireland of Japan made a good effect. Do you think the talk about the Northern Islands of Japan with the Soviet Union made any good effect?
Well, I don't know. We can only hope.
I can also invite Mr. Takeshita to White House in November. You're going to invite Mr. Takeshita to White House in November also?
I need to find out how busy he is with his problem.
So, if you're invited, are you going to come?
Actually, that did not come up. We were busy with too many things.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister.
と握手してください。総理お願いします。はい、どうもすいません。
We have to go to work. Why don't you take the rest of the day off?
ゆっくりなさったら。
We're going to see you again in a minute.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Down.
Done? Okay, sorry, one.
Seemed to think that you had abused his hospitality by talking so much about human rights.
Well, he didn't give me any indication that he felt that way. And we do think that it's an important subject between us.
Sir, when you refused to place the responsibility for not letting the refuseniks out on Mr. Gorbachev, did you really mean to suggest that it was simply the fault of the bureaucracy?
Maybe there was a bad choice of words there. It's the system that I think is, that it is that entire system. We can't place the blame on any one individual.
But doesn't he set the tone in a statist system, sir?
I would be able to answer that. It's a system that's been going on for quite some number of years.
Do you think he really wants to change the whole system and that he
as truck up there, as he has considered his, he very definitely intends to go forward with that and the building and the way things are done.
But he doesn't want you putting that.
I'm just Dorothy. Thank you.
How hard are you going to push? How hard are you going to push?
Well, we make our feelings known when we're there, and he expects that, and actually we parted in a very friendly manner.
But you're going to keep pushing, aren't you?
No, we've got to go.
You should read his speech today. Not readily.
Oh, thank you.
And become a principal guest.
Possibly, we're beginning to take down the barriers of the post-war era. Quite possibly, we're entering a new era in history, a time of lasting
disarmament, proposing nuclear treaties, proposing deployment of counterbalancing weapons, such as intermediate-range missiles, or the more defensive, they said. And when the Soviets left the negotiating table, they were to malign on the first proposal. That provided the basis for the INF Treaty, the first treaty ever that did not just control offensive weapons. These are momentous events, not conclusive, but the bridge.
So let me say simply, at this hour in history, Prime Minister, the entire world salutes you and your gallant people and gallant nation. And while the Union Secretary are saying, nations do not distrust each other because they are armed. They are armed because they distrust each other. Here too, we are now in the third week of the pullout of Soviet troops from Afghanistan. The importance of this step should not be underestimated. And they hear about it 100 times. So if I might go beyond our full partnership today, I want for just a moment to look at personal reflection on the country I saw for the first time. Restructuring. Mr. Gorbachev and I discussed this upcoming party conference where many of these reforms will be debated and perhaps adopted. Secretary of the Soviet Union, walking together in red sweater, talking about a growing personal friendship and meeting together average citizens, realizing how much our people had in common. It was the hand of the Lord, but beyond the Soviet Union. The people whose faces Nancy and I saw everywhere we went. Believe me, there was one thing about those faces that we will never forget. They were the faces of hope. The hope of a new era in human history. And hopefully, an era of peace and freedom for all. And yet, while the Moscow summit, it has never been disputes between the free peoples and the peoples of the Soviet Union that have been at the heart of post-war tensions and conflicts. No disputes among governments over the pursuit of statism and expansion to address the members of the parliament in 1982. I suggested then that the world could well be at a turning point. When the two great threats come to be in effect and will, one that reaffirmed the dignity of the individual in the face of the modern state. I suggested too that in a way Marx was right when he said that political order would come into communion in Eastern Europe. I said that at other times in history, the ruling elites had faced such situations, and when they encountered resolve and determination from free nations, decided to loosen their grip on a wide movement toward democracy, a crusade for freedom, a crusade that would be not so much a struggle of arm and mind, not so much a test of bombs and rockets as a test of bluff Britain who had committed the battalion that held the bridge. Look at him, still with that black mustache. If you put him at the end of a bridge, even today, and say, keep it, he'd keep it. The story mentioned the wife of Cornelius Ryan, the American writer who immortalized Market Garden in his book, A Bridge Too Far, who told the reporter that just as Mr. Ryan was finishing his book, writing the final paragraphs about General Frost's death and stand at Iron, and about how in his eyes his men would always be unrevealed, her husband burst into tears. That toyed in Ryan, and Mrs. Ryan alarmed rushed him. The writer could only look up and say to General Frost, honestly, what that man went through. A few days ago, seated there in Spassel Hospital, Soviet dissidents, I had that same thought and asked myself, what will men suffer for freedom? The dispatch about the armed veteran concluded with this quote from General Frost about his visits to that bridge. We've been going back ever since. Every year we have a reunion? Now there's a word, he turned to his wife. Dear, what's the word for going to Arnhem? Reunion, she said. And Noe said, there's a special word. She pondered. Pilgrimage, she said. Yes, pilgrimage, General Frost said. As those veterans of Arnhem view their time, so too we must view ours. Ours is also a pilgrimage. A pilgrimage toward those things. An American president told his generation that they had a rendezvous with destiny. At almost the same moment, a prime minister asked the British people for their finest hour. This rendezvous, this finest hour, is still upon us. Let us seek to do his will in all things, to stand for freedom,